In 2013, the USDA Natural Resources Conservation Service entered into a cooperative agreement with the South Dakota No-Till Association and IGRO, SDSU Extension, for delivering the latest soil health and productivity technology to South Dakota farmers and ranchers. This event was held in Mitchell.
And thank you for the introduction, and it always embarrasses me when you read all those things, but I watched the Dakota Lake drain, I guess would be, I was after the glaciers, but, and Dan is down in Salina, and I talked about taking deep soil samples, and I teased him a little bit. I said, you can't take anything deeper than 2 feet in South Dakota because you hit rocks. Then I realized you're out there in that good soil where Beck is farming, and there's some good soils in South Dakota, but it was kind of funny. And then Jerry mentioned that, 100 tons soil loss? Do you know that John Pesek was department chair of soil science at Iowa State? And when I was at South Dakota State, about 1970, we met down at Sioux City, four states together. And John Pesek made the comment that we can lose 100 tons of soil, we can put 100 pounds of nitrogen on, and we can grow 100 bushel corn. That's how we felt about erosion at that time. You know, just unbelievable what we do. And you understand that part. That's Don Rutkowski's slide, and I like to use that because that's what we were doing, is burning up organic matter. And so in my home county, which is south of Lincoln, Saline County, it's second county north of the Kansas border, 1879, and some guy accused me of being there, but I read this in a book. But in Saline County, a county 24 miles by 24 miles in 1879 had 57,000 acres of corn growing 40 bushel corn. What kind of corn was growing in the 1870s? Open pollinated. And so then in 1889, it was 48 bushel. Can you imagine picking all that corn by hand, 134,000 acres in that? That intrigues me too, thinking about that. And so the next highest yield, these are an old soil survey, so it had the yields every 10th year. And so 29 was the next highest yield of 33 bushels. So things are starting to deteriorate. You know, and so I graduated from high school in 1955. And so we were organic farmers. And Dad had me cultivate, we cultivated corn four times to mineralize organic matter, and we, you know, got rid of organic matter. And so we were really in bad shape. And then I went to college and learned that you could put fertilizer on and start growing crops. And so, this soil health thing that we're talking about, what Jerry talked about, and that whole thing, and where I'm coming from is on the nutrient side. And in his one slide he had there, in that long-term no-till, more than 20 years that Juca saw put in there, I can use less fertilizer. Now, it doesn't make any sense to me if you're going to be growing better yields, and as Beck said, hauling this stuff off and sending it to China, how can you use less and keep the soil in good condition for 100 years or 500 years from now? So we got to take care of that resource now, and we start with this, and you showed me your app from IPNI, and I stepped my yield goal to 240, so it doesn't quite match what you had, but in IPNI, every bushel of corn we take off the land, we're taking off 3/4 pound of nitrogen, taking off 3,500ths or 1/3 pound of phosphate, 1/4 pound of potash, and then 1/8 of a pound of sulfur and some zinc. But all the other nutrients are there also. And you got all the crops, you got different crops you can do those things for. But just think about that. And we harvested corn from 1870s to 1950s, that's about 80 years, never put anything on except the manure that we fed our cows when we were milking cows and hauled that back on the farm. Grew some sweet clover, grew some alfalfa, moving the nutrients off all the time and not putting on anything because we sold a lot of the grain at that time. And the trace elements are there also. And so you got, now it's 140 years of farming, and we haven't, sometimes haven't put any of these nutrients on. When's the soil going to run out? And so if we're going to have soil health and we're going to build all this stuff up and do all these grandiose things, I think the fertility is a really important part of that. How are we going to keep these soils going? And then I spoke yesterday in Kearney at a CCA meeting, and he said, how are we going to keep, what are we going to do when you old guys are gone, and how are we going to get the young people involved in this? And, you know, you think about that a little bit, and I don't, my wife was up there a while ago. Are you up there? I don't think she's there. She went, oh, there she is. Now she's done chopping already. So, well, we got Dr. Nick Ward is working for us in our laboratory, Ward Laboratories in Kearney. Nick got his PhD at the University of Nebraska-Lincoln last August, and he's got 2 degrees from K-State. He's a grandson. We got Chelsea McCullowitz that is getting a 2-year agribusiness degree from Community College at Hastings, a granddaughter, and her brother is majoring in agronomy and ag business at UNL, and I think his hope is that he can come work for Grandpa also. So so that's how we're transitioning our business over, and hopefully you guys are doing the same kind of thing. We got to get these young people involved, and I'm going to stay mentoring and try to teach them as fast as I can of answering farmer questions, and they can run the business and those kind of things. But these other things kind of really, you think about, you know, most of us think about what are we going to do this year, and right now it's really tough thinking about how you're going to make any money this year. But think about how you're going to keep civilization going. Dave Montgomery spoke down at Salina, and he had this book on soils and lost civilizations. And I think it was the 6th chapter before he started talking about nutrient cycling. And the civilizations, you know, they'd settle in valleys. They'd grow crops in these river valleys, and then over time they'd go up the hillsides, and erosion then would kind of kill the whole civilization. Well, what was happening was at the bottomlands, after you harvest crops or food for a long time and don't return the nutrients, the production goes down, and so then they would expand out. And that's kind of, so if they would, in China there was communities that, or civilizations that recycled everything, and I think Beck said this one time, but if they had guests over their house, they were asked to go to the garden and relieve themselves before they went home to keep the nutrients on their farm. You know, that would be fun, wouldn't it, sometime to have your guests over and tell them? Well, so that, you know, this is what deteriorated our land, and when Jerry talks, he acts like we're over the hump, we can't come back. It's sometimes a little bit more scary, but we did a little land work, and then they had to level it. We put in some big terraces and put these tiles in so we could farm across the waterways because our equipment's getting bigger. It's on our land down at Western, and, you know, then you get more of those. I don't know. I remember as a kid, we had these kind of rains all the time. What Jerry's talking about, I don't quite understand. But we got one of these hellish rains, and you had that erosion. So here's the native soil. It probably got about 2 feet. This is down southeast Nebraska. 18 inches, 2 feet of good topsoil. Over at by York, we had a field day. Here's about 2 inches of topsoil left and about 8 inches of B horizon left. Rest of it is sea horizon parent material. And that's how a lot of our soils on the slopes look today. We've lost probably, I estimate on our farm, 15, 18 inches of topsoil, average off the hills. And now we want to build this stuff back. It's going to take some time to do that. But these are the things we look at. And the first thing that I look at in starting the no-till farming and the soil health is improving soil structure. You have to do that first, and then you can get water in and those kind of things. And I just threw this in here to say the soil structure. And soil structure is important because it retains, it transports water and nutrients. It retains nutrients and helps to transport water into the soil. It's habitat for microbes, and it reduces soil erosion. If you have good soil structure, the granular structure in the topsoil and prismatic structure in the subsoil. So here is an example, a crusted soil, about a 2-inch layer of crust. Crop can't get through there. Now, Jerry talked about this. It's lack of oxygen. So you have this soil sealed, and that's sand. So the raindrops pounding on the soil, and you're separating the sand, silt, and clay. And then you seal that soil. We call it the crust. And in the old days, when we did all the tillage, we had this crust. And now, with keeping the ground covered, you protect the soil from the raindrop, and our soil is more stable and the water goes in. So you got to stop and do that. And that crust, I calculated one time a farmer down in Halstead, Kansas, said something at a field day. And so it made me realize that in 1 gram of soil, about that much, if you had the largest clay particles, 2 microns in diameter. But if you put 5,000 of those edge to edge, you'd have 1 centimeter or 3/8 of an inch. Made a score on that, 5,000 times 5,000 is 25 million. You build that up to 3/8 of an inch cube, you'd have 5,000 times 25 million is 125 billion clay particles in that little tiny place. And then you think air can get through that once that seals. It can't. And so then you have a lack of oxygen for microbes and plants or the roots in the soil, and nothing grows. So to get the good soil health started, the first thing you got to do is build soil structure. So then you get air exchange and do all those things. And this is the culprit. So you got to protect the land from the raindrop splash. That's the first thing you got to think of, is how do I do that? Well, it's a land cover here. Just make sure you got the land covered all the time. And then the cover crop things, we talked a lot about weeds this morning. This is Jody Sadoff at Hildreth, but they were planting cover crop over here in wheat stubble, and then they're planting an angle at this little skip. And he just made the comment that Mother Nature likes cover crops too. And if you don't put something in there, she's going to put some weeds in there. In this case, mare's tail and pigweed. But out here where we have a cover crop, there's not many weeds. So in the soil health thing then, in the cover crop thing, is how do we get all this other stuff working? And of course then the microbes, you can see the mycelium here that you can see. It's a granular structure, and so all these things are working together. And I put together a slide here. It says, I was introduced to no-till planting in the mid-70s. Kentucky was planting corn in the fescue. They'd spray the fescue with paraquat or whatever the other chemical is. And then I took another sentence out of this. And my thought process was, I was working at Oklahoma State, well, we don't have fescue in Nebraska, so we can't do that. You know, that's how we think, you know. And then this guy up there, I run this irrigation farm up at Redfield. They hired me to go up there and start this research and extension center. And then I left and went to Oklahoma State, and Dwayne come up there after a while and was doing stuff. It was just unheard of kind of crap. And I just couldn't believe he could do that. And that's that tillage type thing that you're engraved in there. But in 92, visiting with Martin Jorgensen at Ideal, is when I become convinced that no-till is the way to go. And so we've been no-tilling our farm since 92. And Ideal, South Dakota, when I was at South Dakota State in the 60s, was winter wheat, summer fallow. That was all it was. And then he just made a comment that we can't afford to grow wheat, and he's growing a continuous crops. It's kind of funny. Residue on the ground made me realize that this protected the soil from the raindrop splash. Protection of the soil, protection is water savings at the start. So you think about that. You want to save the soil, but when you cover the ground, right away you start to save water. And that's for us, that's pretty important. Then the next thing I noticed, you go out in my soil health tool, I asked NRCS guy in Lincoln, what would be the best soil health tool? And he just said tile spade. You know, take a spade out and look at your soil. Just, you have to look at it, and that's what I do. And of course, I did that when I was even at South Dakota State. But that worm activity just intrigued me. And then we're trying to get cover crops in there now. And here's a worm. And you know, in this, the worm castings there, I caught him doing that, got the picture. But so how does soil develop? You got the worms, and when we have these field days with Kansas, or the field trips with Kansas guys, I'd spread the trash out and blow and get the kind of chaff out of the way. You could see all these worm castings right on top of the soil where you have that residue there. And I was talking to a guy was Keith Thompson from Osage City, Kansas, about I think the soil develops at the top. Not, you know, when I was in college, you kind of thought that it went down this way. But I think the development's at the top. And he said, Darwin reported that in the 1880s. Then why the hell didn't I talk to him? And he sent me the paper. 1881, Darwin said, the reason artifacts sink in the soil is because the worms are putting the soil up on top. So that 100-year-old house with the sidewalk sinking, no, the soil's built up. So you have to have worm activity in areas where we have worms. You have to have the worm activity to get that soil to build. And tillage, taking the residue off, none of that's there. So you got to keep it protected. Part of soil health is keeping everything fed, and that's been alluded to a lot of times. Now, my tenant, we're on a 50-50 lease, and we've been doing the cover crop, and he's been watching that, so he's doing some now in some of his other land. And he had cows and corn stalks, cows and cover crop, and I didn't ask him this question, but he said he wanted to get the cows home because there's a snowstorm coming in. And I was too kind to him to say, what in the hell do you want to do that for? Because I've learned that your cows can stand to graze, and Beck showed the pictures there of them grazing in the snow. So, but he had a couple bales in the truck, and they went out in his corn stalks, and the cows just followed him through the corral. Got him home, and he went over to the cover crop field. It was pretty much broadleaves, brassicas. And the cows just looked at him. He said he had a heck of a time getting them in the corral to get them loaded. And then he took them home, and they wouldn't even look at those bales when he got them in his home yard. So that's feeding, and corn stalks is not a very good feed compared to fresh roots growing in the soil. So that's where the cover crop thing comes in, because you're feeding that microbes. And then if we mine the nutrients out of the soil and do not replace them, soil health declines. You know, we can grow nitrogen. We got 79% of the atmosphere is nitrogen. So we got things that can fix nitrogen, but we don't get any free phosphorus or potassium on down the line. We don't even get any free sulfur anymore. In Nebraska, that's important. But what I'd like to do in a little bit of time I got is go through some of the soil tests and what would be an ideal soil test to have good soil health. Because I think you need to look at the fertility part to make sure. And here, neutral pH 6.2 to 7.2. If you could be in that range, that's kind of ideal pH. You don't have to have a narrow range. It can be a whole unit apart. If you're very acid, I don't know if there'd be any soils like that. I got one on our farm. It's 4.9. And I didn't know it got so damn low. But so we have some of that, and we've been liming it too. And then moderately acid, and then alkaline 7.3 to 7.8, got a lot of those in South Dakota. And then very alkaline 7.9 to 8.4. If your pH is above 8.4, you got real problems. And we'll talk about sodium a little bit later, but so if you could be, if your acid to get the lime up, and I had a gentleman ask me this morning, I had a pH of 8, how do I drop that? And I don't worry about it. The you can't, and I calculated one time, if you had 4% calcium carbonate in your soil to a foot deep, it'd take 16 tons of elemental sulfur to neutralize that a lime. You just can't change it. So the you need to maybe put a little bit of sulfur on all the time, except we got some real high sulfur tests too, so you have to kind of know. But if in the high pH where you have the calcareous soil, the free lime, when you get wet conditions, the lime starts to dissolve, and you get bicarbonate ions. The bicarbonate moves into the plant, precipitates iron in the plant, and makes it yellow, iron chlorotic. And they said it's iron deficient, but it's got, but those yellow plants have more iron in them than the green plants. And so I know that the plant's getting that iron, it's getting iron in there, but it's being precipitated by that bicarbonate. So the other thing that mass flows in is sulfate. So you put sulfur on, and now you got sulfate and bicarbonate going in, and you have less bicarbonate going in, and it alleviates some of the iron chlorosis problem if you have these high pHs. So if you have a high pH, you know, 30, probably 100 pounds, 150 pounds of ammonium sulfate would be a good source of a sulfur fertilizer to do that. But on the other soils, you know, it's a little easier to take care of. Then the buffer pH, if you do have pH is here very acid or in that 5.1 to 5.6. So I tell guys in the 5.1 to 5.6, you know you're going to have to lime. You maybe don't have to do it this year, but you got to get ready to do it. But when you're below, when you're 5.1 or below 5.1, you really need to be putting lime on. And we determine that with a buffer pH. And the buffer measures total acidity, where pH measures active acidity. So the pH measures the hydrogen ions out in the soil solution, and then there's hydrogen ions sitting on the exchange complex, or kind of exchange capacity, they're sitting on there, and the buffer pH comes along and it scrapes those hydrogens off of the exchange complex, puts it in a solution, and the more hydrogen there that it scrapes off, it lowers the buffer pH. So every 1/10 of a unit drop in the buffer pH, it says it needs 4/10 ton of lime. That's how much hydrogen's in there. 4/10 of a ton of lime would neutralize that amount of hydrogen. So you take 7 minus a buffer pH times 4, and that equals tons of 100% lime, or 4/10 of a ton of effective calcium carbonate is what ECC stands for. And then you divide that by the effectiveness. If it's 60% effective, you divide by 0.6 to get the rate of lime you put on. If you're leasing your land, lime is a capital expenditure. And probably in southeast Nebraska, we've been using 6 years. I pay for the lime up front, and then I charge half of the lime cost back to the tenant over a 6-year period. It's kind of how we're doing that. And that's something you need to think about. Because if you put the lime on and you pay for it and then the guy gets rid of you, you need to have in the lease that you get paid for however many years of that lime. And probably in South Dakota, I probably use maybe eight years instead of 6, but however you want to do that. But it's something that needs to be considered. Soluble salts. And we read soluble salts on every sample because it does a couple of things for us. If you have that white stuff around some of the lower areas, you know, the salts, you know those, and we can detect those. And the other thing, that if we have this 0.1 to 0.75 no crop hazard, EC can be an indicator of soil life. Remember mineralization and organic matter mineralization, if you're kicking out some nitrate and some sulfate out of the organic matter, that would be detected as an EC. And if it's less than 0.1, you can be sure you have a pretty dead soil. And so that's why I use the 0.1 there. 0.75 to 1.5 reduction in sensitive crops. And most of our crops would fall into here, moderate yield reduction if you're above 1.5. And we see those up the in this Mitchell area or in the southern part of South Dakota where we get samples. We'll have some up above 3 even in those high, really high sulfur tests and some of that kind of stuff. As we go on this stuff, you got any questions, please ask as we're going along. This is organic matter. We talk about raising organic matter. And I know Anthony had a deal in his talk this morning on the carbon-nitrogen ratio. He was talking about the residue, or the not the residue, but the crop, the cover crop, and what its ratio should be. If it's 24 to 1 or less, it will start releasing nitrogen for the crop. But in the soil, the carbon-nitrogen ratio is closer to 10 to 1. So here, organic, 1% organic matter, and then in 6 or 7 inches of soil, 1% organic matter, it would have 1,000 pounds of nitrogen, 220 pounds of phosphate, 140 pounds of sulfur, and all the other nutrients. And you know, they get a lot lower concentration. But understand, the reason we talk about organic matter being so important is it has all the nutrients in it. When the pioneers broke the land, broke our sod, they got all the nutrients out of that organic matter. And now we're trying to put it back together. And so if you just do N and P and you need something else, you're not going to build organic matter. And I think the guys that put on farmyard or composted manure or the perfect blend that Jerry mentioned, that supplies all the nutrients because that is all in that manure. Now understand that when we eat whatever we ate for lunch today, we eat that to get the energy out of it to maintain our body's life. Our cells replace minerals, but we don't retain minerals. And so all the minerals that we ate today goes out in the sewage system in the case of humans, in the case of animals, we call it manure. And so all the nutrients that you take off your land, all those plant nutrients and some others, when the animals eat that, almost all that is treated back out in the manure. So the manure needs to go back on the land. And I think those guys that are using manure or compost have a lot better time increasing soil health than those that don't, because we don't get all the nutrients put back that is in the farmland manure. But understand this, if a guy has increased organic matter 1%, you increased, what, 2% or 1.5%? And so you've increased your nitrogen that much in your soil. And that's not from pouring nitrogen fertilizer on. That's from cover crops and a good rotation and legumes in a rotation, all that. And then the residual nitrate, and ask Anthony about that. We the Haney test and the soil health test, we got Haney. And they ignored the subsoil nitrate, which kind of disgusts me. But so we're changing our soil health test. I don't know how soon we're going to have it done, but sometime this spring, we're going to tie our nitrate, our subsoil nitrate, to the Haney test, which right now they're kind of separate tests. And that is available for the next crop, nitrate soluble and move of the soil water. So, you know, this is an interesting thing, the nitrate, and we talk a lot about leaching. And yesterday I reminded the guys too, we're talking about a lot about nitrate leaching. But you know, to have an anion, nitrate's an anion, and to have nitrate go, you have to have a cation with it. And which one are you leaching out, potassium or calcium or magnesium? And I think usually it's calcium. But when you have high sodium in the soil, they recommend applying gypsum. Right? And the gypsum, the calcium, goes on and kicks the sodium off the exchange complex, and the sulfur's there to carry the sodium down, leach it down. And so all those things are there. And in the tile water, you might be losing nitrate, but you're probably losing a lot of other important things in that water too. And I asked Jerry, because one of the things we're losing is carbon. There's bicarbonate in the water, and it just interesting things that I think about sometimes and then don't have time to do much about it. But so I threw in the Haney test here, because the one thing that Rick is doing is evaluating nitrogen, organic nitrogen, how much can be released from there. And I don't have any more details on this one right here than here. And he said traditionally is measuring nitrate. So here we had 14 pounds of nitrate, and then he had ammonia and organic nitrogen. So he's getting the Haney test is 37 pounds. So the difference is 23.6 pounds. And then his nitrogen's priced a little high, but saving $15. And that's kind of the way Haney sold his test, because he showed you guys that you could save money by using his test. And it's one of those things that goes like that over your head. Why the hell didn't we tell you that for years? You know, we've been testing your soil and telling you how much you got to spend, not how much you're saving. And so he's done a good job of marketing that. But there's some good things to show you a little bit more. And then the nitrogen requirement. And Anthony, I thank you, wherever you are, that I've been thinking about, you know, I'm using 1.1 pound of nitrogen, not 1.2 like South Dakota State, but now you think about changing that to 1. And I dropped mine from 1.2 after 2012. I dropped mine to 1.1. But think about this. You take off the grain, you take off 0.67 pound of nitrogen. But I'm telling you, you need 1.1. So there's 0.43 pound of nitrogen that you're putting on, or you have in the soil, but the crop is using it, that's returned every year. 0.43. Where's that going? Well, some is going to organic matter. But I think we might be a little high yet. And so these are things that, Anthony, I appreciate you reporting on that. And the wheat, I asked Beck about the wheat, because Haney's using 1.2 and we're using 2.4, so there's a big difference in our recommendations, but Beck says keep it where it is right now.
Say 2.4, you were allowing for, that's a protein?
Yeah, that we don't think about protein, Dan, and so... Yeah, we're too far south. We grow wheat, so you guys get a chance to get some money. And you get hammered on everything else, so that the wheat is okay to take. And we do grow wheat on our farm, but this would be 12% protein, I think, at 2.4. And I haven't, you know, thought too much about it. I asked Dwayne, I'm thinking about changing it, dropping a little bit, because how in the heck are you going to afford to fertilize wheat? And when it's 380 or whatever it is up here. But understand that in the crops, that long-term thing, and then when the corn pollinates, the corn's still taking up 30% of its nitrogen. Now, some of it's coming out of the stalks and the leaves and stuff, but you still got time. So we need to have a long-term kind of nitrogen thing. And in the irrigation, we talked to the guys about putting a lot of nitrogen through the pivot. And on the dry land, I think we should consider side dressing. And now they got getting high boys that you could put it on later, too, to make it more efficient. So maybe you don't have to put quite as much on. And I teach farmers about, you know, the cow, if you took a load of hay to the cow and said, "Now I'll come back next year and feed you," she probably wouldn't do very well. But you put the nitrogen on and tell corn, "Well, that's it. Get what you can." It's kind of dumb, maybe, what we're doing, if we want to get the efficiency. But so we kind of compensate for putting more on, and so understand those uptakes. Phosphorus, we said attached to the soil particles. The one thing that, yes, phosphorus does move in the soil, because we taught you for years that phosphorus doesn't move. And now we got guys that got phosphorus tests of 500 parts per million in the topsoil, 120 parts per million in the subsoil. And all I know is that's moving to the groundwater. And so we kind of mistaught you some things. And then phosphorus is not fixed, but remains available for the plants for a number of years. The old calcareous thing, soils, you might have a lower phosphorus test, but sometimes you have really high phosphorus test in the calcareous soil, and it's available. The lime does not tie it up. All the lime did was made a Bray test no good. It was a soil test that was wrong, not the application. And so I got Malic 3, Bray P1, and then Olson ratings here. And where on the dry land should you be to kind of maintain soil health and maybe have a year when it's tight, you wouldn't have to put phosphorus on? And I would say at the top of this medium range here, 25 or 15, if you're sitting there, you could skip a year and not hurt yourself, and you'd still maintain good production and always trying to maintain kind of the top end of that medium on your soil. And I think now the irrigators, I've kind of get that up to the high. I haven't gone clear to 50 yet. We do recommend a little up to 50, but probably around 35 to 40 for the guys growing 280 bushel corn. And we're starting to get now questions on 300 or recommendations for corn. So it's going to take more nutrients because you're hauling more off all the time. 300 bushel corn, you remove 200 pounds of 52 a year.
What does a ton of alfalfa?
Alfalfa is 12 pounds per ton. 12 pounds of P2O5 per ton. And the Haney test has that. Well, there's three different parts of Haney test, and one part is H3A extractant, and that is three organic acids that plant roots leak out to feed microbes, and then the microbes are bring them nutrients. And if they're lacking some nutrient they need, they leak out different compounds. But the three they have is citric, oxalic, and malic acid. And then I compare that with our phosphorus, our malic phosphorus test, malic 3 over here. And if you guys know how to read a graph, you can see there's a relationship between those. Here's Adolph Malik was in North Carolina. Bray was in Illinois in the 40s and 50s developing these tests. And it's amazing that they developed something that mimics plants and what the plant's doing. So I think what we've been doing has been good for you guys. And it's not, and we can use this data then to give better fertilizer recommendations off the Haney than what we're doing right now. And the phosphorus, understand that about 40% of the phosphorus is taken up after pollination. And so you get this fertilizer right with the seed or right behind the press wheel or right in front in a 2x2 or wherever, and you get the quick growth response early, and yet 40% of the phosphorus is taken up after pollination. So you kind of need phosphorus out where the roots are growing to take that phosphorus up. So you have to, and that's why we need that good phosphorus test to feed that crop later on in the season. The early response might go into yield, it might not. Depends on the year and the perfect day. Sometimes you get it and sometimes you don't. And then potassium, and you guys are watching my time, aren't you? Well, this guy's gone. I'm in great shape. 10 minutes. Oh, there you are up there. I figured you had to be here somewhere. Potassium. Here, I just like to be at up to 200. Maybe the dryland guys somewhere it'd be 160. And I was talking to a gentleman earlier, and he says he's getting response of potassium, kind of at anywhere. And then you ask him some of the questions. I think you know chloride's important. And 0060 is potassium chloride. It's 60% K2O and 45% chloride or Cl. So it's a good chloride source. But when we're, the guys are complaining that the potassium tests are dropping. We used to not have any issues with it. And I remember even at South Dakota State in the 60s, I did a summary one time because there's guys up northeast South Dakota saying that they needed potash in their soils because they had a high pH. And we did a summary and we had it all categorized by great soil group or soil groups. And sure enough, up northeast South Dakota, there was an area there that 60% of the soils had it, we were calling for potassium. And it was kind of interesting when we did the summary to find that true. So this one, keep watching that potassium, because if it's dropping quite a bit, you might want to start putting some on just to kind of maintain, keep your productivity up. If it's not dropping, you don't need to worry about it. And then the H3A test and the potassium, again, there are different readings, but it's still related to our ammonium acetate extraction thing. But to understand that plants on potassium, the main potassium use or taken up is when the plants are growing rapidly. Doesn't matter which one it is. And in the case of corn, by the time it tassels, 90 to 95% of the potassium is taken up. So when the corn is growing real rapidly and that, you know, when it's knee high to head high, it might only take 2 weeks to do that, you're taking up a lot of potassium. That's why we want that potassium test pretty high, because you got to supply the potassium in that time frame. Maybe 8 to 10 pounds of potassium going in a day on the plant. Now, when you take the grain off, you only take off 1/4 pound per bushel, but most of the potassium's in the stalks and the leaves, so that recycles every year. And so we don't, it won't drop as fast. You don't need a lot to put on. Sulfur tests. And in South Dakota, this is real critical. We got some soils that are just higher in heck in sulfur, and then others that are really pretty darn low. And we do a lot of subsoil testing for sulfur, and we'll have those 1,000 part per million sulfur tests, and we'll have 2 part per million sulfur tests. Sometimes in the same darn, for the same farmer. So I don't know if they're in the same field or just different fields. So kind of watch that. And if you're on sandy soils, you really need to make sure you have some sulfur early. But most of the sulfur and nitrogen goes into proteins in the plant. They kind of go together. So it's always a good idea if you want to put sulfur on to put it apart. If you're using liquid nitrogen, to go ahead and mix the 28 or 32 in thiosulfate. If you're wanting to do that with a herbicide, you got the thiosulfate's kind of a tough, but otherwise you can mix those two together. Calcium, magnesium, sodium, and there's lots of talk about that, but part of the base saturation should add up to 70% or greater. Calcium, magnesium, I got sodium here. I should have potassium in there also. Sorry about that. So calcium, magnesium, sodium, and potassium should be greater than 70% of the base saturation. I think if you're above 30%, you better be putting lime on. There's some people say that that's a different, but
I've heard some talk about calcium magnesium ratios.
That's in this slide here. Summary of calcium magnesium ratio concepts unproven and should not be used as a basis for fertilization. So, and that's not my slide. I copied that from somebody. So the hydrogen, the other cation up here in the base saturation is hydrogen, and that's acidity. And so that would tell you if you're acid or not. And if that's less than 30, I wouldn't worry about it. But if it's above 30, if you're working your pH, wonder if you should put lime on. Look at the base saturation. If it's above 30, get it put on. The other problem with the base saturation is sodium. And if that sodium percentage is greater than 5%, there is a problem. And normally we call that an alkali or sodic soil. And so we can recommend gypsum. If it's an EC, soluble salt reading, above 1.5, that's a saline condition. If it's sodium greater than 5%, that's a sodic. They're two different things. And some people want to put gypsum on a saline soil, and all gypsum is another salt that you're putting out there. So you're increasing the salinity. But if you have a sodium problem, then you need to put gypsum on, because that calcium sulfate will get rid of the sodium. But if you have a saline alkali soil or saline sodic soil, and you put an entire line to start draining that, then you need to get the soluble salts out first. And when the salts drop, then put the gypsum on for the sodium. Don't put the, you'll just waste your gypsum until you get the salts leached out. Anthony, is that right? You're sitting back there. Well, it's a, and I learned a lot of these things working in South Dakota on the salinity thing. So that's the way I would handle that. And then we saw this one. In zinc, I think most of our zincs are fairly decent in South Dakota on the glacial soils. In Nebraska, wind-blown deposits are less soils. Our soils are natively low in zinc, and of course we put a lot of zinc on especially on the irrigated crops, and we're pretty high now, but we need to have this above one. I don't think you need to be any higher than that. And when we make recommendations for zinc, these rates here are the pounds per acre, and there's a big range because, like alfalfa, really doesn't need much zinc, but corn's the most sensitive to zinc. And if you got corn in the rotation, then you got to build that zinc up. If you got wheat and alfalfa and those kind of things, you could get by with the lower part here. And but if the recommendation we make, I say divide the rate by 6 amount per year if you don't want to put all of it on at one time. The other thing, if you're wanting to mix zinc with 1034-0, you can put 1 pound of zinc with 7 gallons of 1034-0. And you can use ammoniated zinc or a chelated zinc other than EDTA. The polyphosphate sequesters the zinc and holds it, so you can use ammoniated zinc or one of the lower cost chelates. Now, if you're using a low salt fertilizer that's got orthophosphate, the only chelate or only zinc you can use is EDTA chelate, because orthophosphate precipitates zinc like that. And you'll end up with a hard white powder in your pump if you do that. So if you're using an orthophosphate fertilizer, use EDTA zinc. If you're using 1034-0, you can use ammoniated zinc or a cheaper one. And there's even some relationship with H3A and our regular DTPA zinc test. So we're going to be able to work on these things. I think manganese, we got 3 here, is high. Do you know there's soils in this area here that we have over 100 parts per million manganese in them? And I think these are wet soils that are lack of oxygen maybe. And I wonder sometimes if some of the problems with the, Jerry mentioned yellow crops and lack of oxygen, and if there's manganese toxicity. But that's one thing that I would watch a little bit. If you got really high manganese, might be time to get it sold. No, I don't. But I don't know, because there might be other problems. But just kind of watch that. If you have, now the manganese, most of the time would be, with the high pH would be this, but we see the high pH and they're like 80 to 100, 120 parts per million manganese, and so there's something going on. I don't know what that is. And then copper. Anthony, thanks again for having all those tests, because this confirms that when you have high tests, you don't need any of that stuff. And so copper, if we're above 0.2, we don't need to put any copper on, except the potato guys in Nebraska, and they're from Watertown, CSS Farms, they want the copper test at 0.6. So we recommend copper for potatoes, but we don't for any other crop. And then boron. We're getting, in northeast Nebraska, we're getting some low boron, and I think what I've seen in South Dakota, most of the time it's pretty good in the tests we get. And be careful with it. When I started at South Dakota State, they still talked about using borax as a soil sterilant. So you can ruin things if you put too much boron on, so be careful with it. And then chloride is the other one. And this is K-State. Is South Dakota State higher than that, Anthony? This is a 2-foot test. And we go up to 6. Are you cutting off at 6 or 8?
Well, 60 pounds of chloride.
Okay, 60. In K-State wants 30. So in Nebraska, I use 45. You know. Now understand, when I first started this talk, I talked about structure in the soil health situation. And then we talked about nutrients. But the main thing you need for nutrient uptake for root growth is oxygen. And you think about that when you get rain, water goes in the soil and air comes out, which is carbon dioxide. And then the plant uses the water and air comes in, which is oxygen. And if you have good soil structure, all you have is the earth is a great big lung breathing in and out carbon dioxide and bringing in oxygen. And that's what we're trying, that's what soil health is all about, I think, is and how we do that with the microbes and all that. You've heard plenty of those other things. So the soil health, the progression, I see the improvements in our soils. Haney tests the indicator of soil biological life. If biological activity increases in my soil, can I reduce my fertilizer and pesticide inputs? That's what this is all about. And I know the fertility, we might be able to get more efficient on our fertility because we're not washing any soil away. So we should be able to maintain our soil test easier. But it doesn't mean that we have to put less on if we've been taking good care of our soil. So I got a PFA test on one of my soils, and the diversity index was 1.6, which as Lance says is the highest you can have. And so I went to Lance and said, can I reduce my fertilizer? And he thought for a little bit, and he says, no. He said, but I think you can reduce your other input costs. And it's a diversity in this weed thing that Steve talked about this morning. Those are the things that were issued, and that's what we got to work on. How do we get things that we need to learn to work with Mother Nature instead of fight her all the time? And then is this the system of the future? And of course, I think it is, but these are the kind of questions that we have. So I appreciate you guys letting me come talk to you and enjoyed it. Enjoyed the program today.
Any questions for Dr. Ward?
Grazing cover crops, but say I've got 2,000 pounds of biomass, and out of that I've got 120 pounds of nitrogen. If I graze that, them cattle, what's going to happen? If I don't graze it, it's going to be there, but what's going to happen if I graze that?
So if you graze, and I did this with corn in the feedlot, I had a bunker of corn, and I went and took a picture of it and then decided how much of that phosphorus in the corn is in the manure. And I went, it was about 92%. And on the nitrogen, I think it maybe is closer to 85% is returned in the manure. So there is, you know, the muscle's got some protein in it and that kind of thing. So, and you retain a few minerals. But the reason we eat, the reason animals eat things is for energy, number one. And then when we grow, we might retain a little bit of nutrient. But almost all of that is excreted back out. And then the other good thing about that, Dan, is that you got the microbes in the rumen that is increasing your soil life in the soil. So I think there's advantage to that part, too.
I know there's quite a few areas anymore in eastern South Dakota, at least parts of the field, where they're getting pretty acidic. But a lot of the recommendations on liming is always based on tillage and working it in. So if you are going to put lime on no-till, you still use the same rate on those acidic spots, or you have to use less because so you don't raise the real top pH too high?
The short answer is don't worry about it. Go ahead and put it on. And I was an advocate of splitting it three ways and put one third on, and then 2 years later put another third on 2 years later. And I was in an American Society of Agronomy meetings in a poster section walking through. Dr. Larry Bundy from Wisconsin had a poster about lime application no-till. And I said, read it a little bit, and I said, you can do that? And he said, yeah, don't worry about it. So I never have worried about it since then. So I think you can put it all on. And you know, the worm activity and the microbe activity and all that, it moves that pretty fast.